Good morning, everyone. Hello, everyone. We're here in the campus, virtual campus of Istituto Italiano Design, and we're going on with our webinars. IID is open. Buongiorno a tutti, siamo qui nel campus virtuale dell'Istituto Italiano Design. Oggi il nostro webinar sarà in English. We are going to take this session in English. We're here talking about today the design and artificial intelligence. And in particular, design transformation, and how the artificial intelligence is going to change design with along with other technologies. We're here with a special guest, who is Yannis Paniaras from Seattle, and he is the design manager of Microsoft. I will leave the screen with our communication professor Nicola Palumbo, and
Hi.
enjoy the session. Hello, everyone,
Thank
and enjoy.
you. Thank you, Benedetta. Thank you for the introduction. And it's a pleasure to have this opportunity to talk with both of you, but also like the students that are joining us today to cover this fascinating topic. Like Nicola, would you like to add something?
Yeah. So welcome, everybody, and thank you, Yanis, for being here with us. So, a little introduction of you and your life and your work, just to know who you are. I know that a lot of people know that, but let's start talking about your life. So, you are Greek Italian, right? And you
Yeah.
studied fashion design in Italy and fashion product design in Helsinki. How was this situation?
Yes, I mean, first of all, I hope everybody who is joining us is well and safe, right? Wherever you are, I understand we have some participants joining from Italy, obviously, and I'm hearing from India. I think I'm not sure what is the time in India now. Perhaps someone can tell me. So I have a mental idea of.
Yeah, maybe
Maybe afternoon, I would say probably it's like Friday afternoon.
6 or 10 hours after, maybe.
I'm here like it's 11 in the evening in Seattle, obviously. It's the end of the day, that's fine. So as Nicola said, that like my name is Yannis Paniara, so I'm a design manager at Microsoft, and I have been with Microsoft for several years. This was the third time actually I joined the company, and since 2 years ago, I kind of like sh shifted a bit what I'm doing, and in particular, it's a personal interest, but also it's like part of my work lately to look into how design is transforming essentially,
Yeah.
because there's a lot going on. But back like a bit about my future. In fact, indeed, I have more of a classic education. In fact, in fashion design, where I studied in Italy and then also in Finland. And the reason I went to Finland was I was 3 years actually in Italy. Studying in Firenze and in a place called Polimoda, but then I went to Helsinki at another university. And the reason I went there was because I wanted to experience a different culture. Obviously, Scandinavia has a different set of values, and they see design differently, as well as the society is organized in a different way. But surprisingly, as I was in Finland, I met I went actually I met I, I the university has a, had an amazing media lab. It was a lab full of computers and toys and all of the digital technologies and high-end systems. And I was very curious, like, what are the systems doing? And that's how I kind of like got exposed to computers, like designing with computers. And obviously those years, it was early 90s. It's probably now, 18 years
Yeah,
ago.
it's the Aalto University, right?
The Aalto University, yes. And in fact, they had the best digital lab in Finland. That university set up the media lab. Was one of the best in Finland, very well funded. And so, of course, those machines were, very old compared to today's standards. But again, there was a good community of people looking into like what are these technologies. And this is how I kind of like I was doing, of course, like fashion design and even making the clothes with my hands and trying other things. But also I was working with these digital systems. So little by little I became more fascinated more and more, and ended up actually, the last 1.5 year in Helsinki, I was working with virtual identities. Essentially, that was a
Yeah.
time when online virtual communities will be we were able actually. Today is very common, right? But 18 years ago, and even 15, because it was the end of my stay in Finland, it was actually the beginning, and that's how I kind of like got involved in the world of software, And my first job then was in the US, and since then I have been in software and tech companies.
Yeah, right. How did you end up getting your first job in Silicon Graphics?
Because I was spending a lot of time designing, like, for these virtual environments, the 3D scenes. And inside these 3D environments, we have users, how we represent ourselves, right? Like, we call them avatars, actually, today. But yeah, it's not really fancy. I mean, today it's very common. But it was
the period of Second Life, I remember.
Yes. And I mean, there is a connection, obviously, how you represent yourself physically in the real world, right? And how you do it digitally in a virtual world. And there's a layer of culture, obviously. There's what technology enables, and there's an element of collaboration and entertainment. And then Silicon Graphics at that time was a dominant company. Probably now they are still around, but Silicon Graphics was designing these high-end systems for virtual reality. And I was lucky and I got an internship there. So I moved there for actually 3 months, but then I ended up being there for more than a year because I was very fascinated and they liked like how I was working and I liked them as well. And since then, it was kind of like, you know, a way of I continued working in software companies, typically engineering companies.
Yeah. How your studies in fashion design helped you think and solve design problems in the user experience design today? So how?
Because the classic education in design in general, classic education is always valid, right? Because no matter what technology, the technologies come and go, and technologies after 2 years, two, 3 years, they become obsolete. In fact, the best designers, it's a bit like being an architect, right? You need to know fundamentals in design. And I think fashion design, it wasn't only fashion design. There was also history, art history, fashion history, social implications. And it's not just like I'm designing clothes. There's a lot more context, right, behind. And I think these fundamentals, actually, they follow you, right? But one thing was also like the essence of ergonomics, I would say, right? There is fashion is still creative, but still you need to comply with, you know, the ergonomics of a human body. It's a bit like architecture. And I think in UX, user experience, if I use the term UX, means user experience. UX is like this sense of accessibility, we call it, right? Accessibility. Yeah. Like essentially, like when you design the systems, you need to consider the human element. And in fashion design, you are still creative. You have to be creative. Yet you have this very classic traditional thinking about like it has to be comfortable, right? It has to be safe. It has to be practical. You need to wash it. You need to use it many times. You need to recycle it lately, right? There's this a lot of other variables there that are hidden. Well, in the world of software and UX, it's a bit the same. You need to consider all of these things, like a lot of millions of users need to use it, different cultures. It has to be safe. It has to perform. Yeah. So there is an analogy there. These things are similar. You just apply the theory into a different practical context.
Talking about different cultures, I know that you lived for many years in China, right? And as a founder and designer, how did your experience in China influence your perspective and about the difference in culture and design and world in general?
Definitely a lot. Actually, again, it was by coincidence, I would say, that I ended up in China. Of course, I wanted to go to China, and it was after I had spent 4 to 5 years in California working there. And at that time, I thought like, well, the U.S., I had seen enough of the U.S., but somehow I had this instinct that China as a country, as a culture, as an economy will rise. And that instinct proved to be kind of like right. And I went to Beijing in 2002, I believe, end of 2002. And I ended up, again, I went there for 1 year only and ended up being there for 13 years. And it was probably the time of my life that have shaped the most my perception about the world, and maybe changed myself as well, because I suddenly was involved in a very different culture, and I was a designer also, not a foreigner, but also a designer. And I believe that like China will rise and will become an innovator and strong in technology, but they're also very strong in design, I think, because again, there's a culture. If you look at it like this, and the reason why we perceive China the way we look at it like 30 years ago, it was just like because of economic reasons, right?
Yeah.
There is a lot of like science and innovation in China. It's just like the economy was then economic development was lower, and now has took off actually.
Do you have an opportunity to fly back to China sometimes for your work?
Of course, I try to go there every year if possible, at least once, sometimes twice. I have big network there with people, etc. But in China, obviously, like as a designer, the first years were a little bit difficult, I would say, because China, a lot of the business part of China, right, would not really understand design very well, in a sense, like to value the design. But things took off dramatically after the Olympics, I think, after 2000. We saw the signs around 2006, 2007. And after the Olympics, the country opened up and there was a lot of more awareness about design. And in fact, today, some of the best UX design teams are based in China. Like you have Alibaba, very big design team. Tencent, the company who is making, you know, the WeChat applications. They're very, very big and mature design teams, I would say now. And in general, like in automotive, industrial design, robotics, China is innovating very strongly. And I think India as well has taken actually a path towards that I think it's a few years ago. It's not only back. And I know because, I mean, Microsoft, we have a campus in Hyderabad and in Bangalore, a big presence, engineering, okay. A lot of designers there. So there's a lot happening in India as well. I'm surprised a bit because typically it's like sometimes when I look at like where are the opportunities in design, like for people like me, and they ended up being either in the US or China these days, and perhaps in the future in India.
And what about Japan? Japan lost his, you know, position in like leader in innovation or design. What do you think?
I would say, I don't know about the innovation, because in technology, I'm more familiar with technology in general. But Japan is a bit more traditional, I would say. You know, if you remember, like in the 80s and 90s, there was Sony and Toshiba and robotics. I think they have strong technology yet. But however, in UX, when it comes to user experience and software, they have not managed actually to, for some reason, I don't know why, what was the reason for that. And in fact, like sometimes we, within the user experience community, we kind of like struggle a bit to understand where are the designers actually in Japan, right? Because a lot of them are doing like the arts and crafts. They're very good in the traditional arts, perhaps industrial design. Maybe it's some kind of the culture in trying to focusing on things that are done by hand, are a little bit like in Thailand, there's a bit of connection maybe there, right? There is this appreciation, and maybe in Italy or some European countries, because when you have a lot of history around the making things, right, with quality, and then you have this different way of designing, which is digitally, and it uses scale and different data, it's a different beast, actually. And I think maybe we can discuss it a bit later, but I think both of these directions will become valid.
So let's talk about your work in Microsoft. So I understand that currently Microsoft, you are focusing on design transformation, right? So can you share more with us what are the underlying forces that are causing design transformation?
Yes. I mean, it's like a bit like it works like this. You may hear the term digital transformation. Like you will see it often in magazines and in the internet, in TV or in general, like everybody's talking about digital transformation, both at the government level, at the society level, businesses are talking, education, even what we do today, having this event around the world in three different parts of the world. It's happening because of digital transformation in a way. But digital transformation doesn't mean only using digital tools, right? It means that actually how we change our processes to design. Because yes, the tools, the digital tools are there, right? So we have digital transformation. And then design transformation essentially is part of digital transformation. We are changing the way, the process of how we design digitally. And the biggest, and I saw like a question, participants.
Design transformation.
What do we mean? And I think the underlying force essentially is like the data, big data. This is what is changing and it will keep changing. And why do we have data? Is because we're using hardware that has more and more sensors. We didn't have sensors like years ago. And the sensors are basically, you know, your iPhone or your Android phone has many sensors. Your computer has sensors. IoT and your house has sensors. public transportation has sensors, right? The cities, you're wearing maybe something on your wrist, like a watch or a healthcare device. Your car has sensors. Essentially, think about the world, the physical world around us is being populated with these sensors, billions of sensors, maybe trillions.
IoT, right?
Yeah,
IoT,
smart homes, etc. So these sensors are recording the world. I will repeat, they are recording the world. So essentially, through all of these sensors, you have data. And then we use this data to actually derive assumptions about designs, essentially. Before, like 20 years ago, even 10, we didn't have that data. So we will make, how would you go, for example, to design a design collection, right? Whether it is furniture or whether it is like fashion design or let's say patterns for textile or interiors, you probably, we had a different process. We had a creative director maybe, or this a team of designers. They will look maybe in history, or they will look into inspiration. They will create things. It's all human centered, right? Basically, all the activities, the ideas were coming from our brains and the history. And then they will have a process, decide, and they will say this will sell without necessarily knowing whether it will sell a lot or not. Marketing will come in and say, we think that, you know, this style will sell more. But again, it was all human driven. There was no data behind. Yeah. In the world of software, of course, the world of software did this a lot earlier. They did it 20 years ago. They did it 10 years ago. If you look at like Windows, for example, it's an old product which is dying. And we know that we are fine with it going away. But the Windows is has telemetry. We call Windows has telemetry. When users are using Windows, Microsoft knows, they don't know what I do, but they know that like I use this feature more than the other. And essentially, yeah, and thus they have this information to say, well, this feature, I need to remove it. And users want
change
that.
It. Yeah.
Essentially, this digital data is informing companies what to do, including Apple, Airbnb, Uber, airlines, etc. So the digital data. Now, digital data starts to inform what type of physical products we may need or like.
Yeah, this is one of the questions of our professor in shoes design. How is data influencing design? So you're answering now.
In the sense that like it is giving us the signals, the data can be analyzed by people, but humans, but also. And Isabella, my friend, is asking, is data influencing design? Yes, absolutely. But we need to have the right process also. Without the process, we cannot consume the data. And the data can be lean, a little bit of data. If the data is simple, humans can analyze it. But sometimes the data is very complex and too much. And then it's machines. Machines will analyze it. Or another, a new discipline, which we call data analysts, data analysis. They are experts. And in fact, they're paid very, very well to do that. And today, for example, Amazon has a division here in Seattle. They have a division about home interiors, furniture, lights, etc. In fact, Amazon is already experimenting using data to design things for the house that will have a higher probability to be sold. You see, before we were creating the chairs and the lamps and the interiors, the decoration by human creativity. Now there is this human creativity, but there are also the data. And if the data says maybe this shape, this lamp will sell more, 18% than the other, and this color, this combination, then that's how they drive the design direction.
There is another question, which is the process to create a new product in Microsoft. I know it's a big question.
It's a big question, and the world of software is a bit different. There's also another question within Microsoft: what are the right methods to create design for a new product?
Yeah, method. Yeah,
yeah. That's also a good question because I would say there are a few more than one probably. Why? Because some products are enterprise products, for example, for businesses. Other products are for consumers. And so on and so forth. But typically, we start at looking at the user. I will give you some very classic guidelines here, right? We're looking at the user, essentially. User means that, like, who is the end user? What do they need? What problems are we trying to solve? And typically, this means there's research involved, and the research will analyze, like, okay, this cohort of people, and typically, the users sometimes may be millions of users. Like, if you're using Outlook, for example, for your email, And what problems are we trying to solve? So we have four phases, actually. We call the discovery phase, understanding what problems need to be solved, and try to map this with, for example, if you are doing fashion design or communication design, you still try to address a problem, right, that humans have. We need to have a product design that has these requirements. And then we are going, after the discovery and understanding what needs to be designed, then we are actually formulating some strategies. There's a strategy that says perhaps we need to approach this problem in this way. And we use some key metrics, it's called, like key metrics. The product needs to have certain metrics, for example. Well, in the world of software, it's probably very different, because you will say the user needs to accomplish this task effortlessly with two clicks, for example. Or the user may be able to actually to search, like, let's say, 1,000 emails in 1 second. I'll give
you the shortest process to have a task.
Yeah, so these are the key. Some of them are high-end and low-end. Then we prototype. We need to prototype things. We're not going, we don't go right straight into developing, because development is very expensive. So you prototype these scenarios, and products will have a few scenarios, right? We prototype some scenarios. Then you make some assumptions, then you go back and reassess. And at some point you develop. And at some point you start developing the actual software. We have coders and designers and testing and so on and so forth. Then you release the software to the users and they start using it. And then we get new data. There's new data coming in. And then this new data fuels the next cycle that restarts, because the product never ends. In contrast to a physical product, you design and it's done, you cannot change it. That's the difference there. But in the world of software, it changes every time if you want.
There are a lot of questions, so I have to be really fast. So we have another question. Did you find Finland a place to be becoming to design? Would you recommend us to move there for starting?
It's definitely an interesting place, because Finland and in general Scandinavia, because they have, first of all, the way they organize the society there is a bit different, and it's very, very human-centric in a sense, right? And they are very, I would say Finland more than Sweden and Denmark and Norway. Finland is a bit more forward-thinking. They are kind of like very forward-thinking, and they dare to do things that the other countries don't. So it's definitely... one of the best places maybe to, it is definitely not a stereotypical place to study there.
Which design, thank you, Benedetta, she's helping me. Which design job profiles will AI be able to replace? Artificial intelligence?
Yes. I have been studying this a little bit actually, and the last year also with some colleagues inside Microsoft. So I think it's not going to be maybe replacement in that in the traditional sense, and I think we should not look at it like in a black and white scenario, but I think like the repetitive tasks essentially and I'll give you an example, like in the world of user interface design, many designers, including today at Microsoft, they are going to design, let's say, a mobile application. They do manually each screen needs to be designed, the buttons, the icons, the form, the text, all of that is done manually even today, increasingly a bit with some automation. All of that can actually be automated, but it doesn't mean the designer will not be there. The designer will move to do something else. So to me, this suggests that the repetitive tasks can be automated. So AI and machine learning can actually take that over, right? But in fact, AI doesn't work on its own. It needs a human instructor. I call it a design orchestrator. So instead of actually being a designer and say, I'm going to do this now 100 times to finish all my job, you're going to design more the pattern, right? It's the combination of A, B, C, and F, and G, and I want that. And then the machine can crank out like fast this for you, all of these things. So it means you will have more time to think. I have a term for that. I call it meta designer. The next level of design is that, like, you need to think a bit like more the bigger questions. Are you solving the right problem?
And then the strategy, you have to give the strategy, and then
the machines will actually do repetitive tasks, which are anyways, they are not very creative. But until now, we had to do them because no one else will do it. It's a manual work.
So we need more vision and less manuality.
Yes, exactly. Designers will need to pay more attention. on understanding, first of all, maybe understanding the world around them, trying to find through their designs, solving the right problems, taking into consideration new dimensions, like, for example, social equality, climate change, energy consumptions, things that we didn't bother to think in our designs 10 years ago, right? And so these are the new frontiers in design, where whether you're doing software, designing communications or fashion or an interior or industrial design, there will be these new pockets where we will be innovating. And then the repetitive task, maybe increasingly, will be done by machines.
Someone is asking to explain better, what do you mean with meta design?
I think we had a question about virtual reality or augmented reality and interior design.
No, meta design. You talked about meta design, and if you can explain better this.
Meta design. It's a bit of a personal thing. Personal thing that I invented, maybe. Yes, it's meta designer and meta design, because I couldn't explain to my colleagues inside Microsoft. Like, I wanted to give them, like, you know, you are a designer now, but 2, 3, 5 years from now, you will be doing maybe 50% of what you do, you will be different. And I wanted that kind of like to give them a word to mentally take them over to the future. And I said, you will become a meta designer, meaning you will be doing new things in design that we are not doing today. And of course, we don't have all the answers. So it means, like, maybe think about it, it's more like the designer of the future, in a sense, something like this.
There are a lot of questions about, this was the question, one of the questions, but this one is one a lot of people is asking you, what would you suggest to young people wanting to work in your field? So about the career.
Is it like in tech technology companies, in the software, or is it like product? Because it's also product design that uses software and not being, you know, they create the real products at the end. They manufacture real products. Is it like the question about software?
No, I mean, a lot of students want to know which is the best career to work in your area, your sector.
I mean, in general, whether you're designing software products, right, or physical products, tangible products that you manufacture, that are built, increasingly we will use different types of technologies to make them. So the human creative artistic dimension will remain, but there are, I see, two different paths and maybe somewhere in between. If it is digital, then you need actually to understand the technology, study the technology, understand the future, and maybe even take courses. But it doesn't mean you are a programmer, right? If it is physical, there is also a possibility to actually do high-end, expensive, you know, luxury products, and these will not necessarily be digitally made. And I don't know how the second one.
And this is the other question. Do you think companies such as Microsoft will be looking to include product and fashion designers in their team?
Yeah, that's from Isabella. Yeah, I see. Okay. Maybe actually Microsoft is not, probably not. But you know what? Facebook, surprisingly, is doing a lot of work around fashion. That's why they have this Fashion +++ project, where they analyze millions of photos of users and they try to understand the trends, right? But somehow it's what they're creating services. They're not creating fashion items, right? They're creating services which they sell to other companies to generate the fashion. So Amazon too. Amazon has the data and analytics. So for me as a designer, I find it boring, right? So we designers will find it boring. I mean, we will need to be using this data that constrains us of what to do. If I had an idea which is very creative, suddenly I am a slave to this data, right? It takes away a little bit my creativity. We haven't solved that problem yet. So yes, it's not all fascinating. And so that's why I say this, all of this is work in progress. It will take years, maybe. Maybe it will take us to 2025, unless there's a new equilibrium. And that's why by that time, that's the meta designer thing, right? Maybe we will be happy doing things differently, but maybe we will say enough with the digital world. Yeah. I don't want that. And maybe we go back and some of us will say, I want to do things with my hands in expensive things and become more of, like, you know, a different type of designer.
Another question is, can you give us some advices to become good designers?
I mean, good is today. I mean, look at the fundamentals in design. Would be like think of the user always. It's not because the world kind of like expects that. That the main meaning, looking at the user, meaning like understanding what the user needs and what the problems we're trying to solve. Not only rely on your own personal creativity. Let's say you are very creative a person, and you can create amazing, you know, expressions of designs in graphics or in fashion or forms or in furniture. But still, the world has to buy this, and you need to solve the problem for the people. And we have more and more people around the world, consumer societies, right, in Asia, in India, in Latin America, even in Africa. They want products to solve their problem. So potentially a better career path would be like if you try to understand the user and through your design solve those problems in ways that are either economical or human or pleasant, you know, aesthetics. There's a lot of things there going on.
Yeah, this is another question. No, someone changed my question. Okay, thank you, Benedetta. The, yeah, the question was what the companies need, which is the best career for a designer to work for a big company? The skills, which are the skills a designer needs?
Well, I mean, it will be, of course, like, some of the foundational skills we will get through education, like, you know, like form and color, typography, form and function. These things actually will never go away. They're very traditional things, but they are not enough anymore, I think. And again, it's a bit of the, if I answer one way, maybe not necessarily, I may not answer completely, because if you are in software, then it's more like digital technologies and user experience. However, if some of you are having a path to design objects, let's say, like really your product designers, even fashion designers, product design, I think you should seriously start to understand how the digital technologies are, how you will use these technologies to inform you and the companies that you will be working, they will be using processes, right? And then these are learned at the company usually.
Yeah,
because you may know, like, there's a company in Yoox. Actually, Yoox is an Italian company. You probably know it, Yoox.com, but also Zalando, Yoox, yeah. And Zalando, Yoox is using data to design collections, like the, I think it's called 8 something, Yoox 8. There's a brand that Yoox is creating. They're using the data from the users. And then Zalando is a very big e-commerce, German e-commerce site for fashion design and accessories, which are, they are also using the data for the users. And surprisingly, for example, they had some positions 2 years ago in marketing, and they were asking these people in marketing actually to be able to code. It's a, you see, like 5 years ago, you never ask a marketing person working
to code
their site to be able to code, but they wanted them to code. Why? Because they're going to get the data and they need to crank up some algorithms from some formula to derive meaning out of this data, right? Otherwise, yeah, there is a job.
There is another question which is really close to me, because I teach, you know, web marketing, this thing. So what is the influence of global social platforms in design, such as Facebook, Instagram, WhatsApp, WeChat?
Right now it's kind of like it's midway, I would say, because like there is an influence, but they haven't leveraged yet. The big platforms are now monetizing, right? They started, like, of course, Facebook is the biggest one, but there's other ones. LinkedIn, for example, is also a social platform.
Yeah.
And it's for professionals. So there is like YouTube and Instagram, etc. But we start seeing now what's happening with all of the information we generate with users, and we generate photographs, we generate videos, we type. We have sentiments, right? Liking, disliking things. We have geography, people connecting with people. Then these data are starting to inform trends, essentially. So that's why I was saying Facebook, with this product they have, it's a project actually called Fashion Plus Plus. They are able to understand style based on the photo. So every time I upload photos of me in a particular context, let's say I am in a party, summertime, and I'm in Greece, in a Greek island, and I wear this thing. And there's another
100 this summer to do that, Yannis.
Yeah, and then imagine now this, like a 300 million photos out there around the world. The machines, the artificial intelligence and machine learning, computer vision it's called, when a computer understands the photograph, they start understanding, like, in Greece, they wear this color this year, right? Or today. In Italy, in Milan, they are actually wearing umbrellas. Suddenly it's raining. I mean, it's mind-boggling. It's going to be crazy because at that point, then Facebook can actually understand what's happening around the world in fashion in real time, right? And if you know that picture, suddenly your designers in Italy, in Milan, or in Los Angeles, or in Tokyo, they can start actually digitally adjusting the designs. You know, completely different things.
You know, we are in Italy, so one question about Italy, there must be. So Italy is known for its tradition and experience in design. So how is digital transformation going to influence design? Because we have, you know, an important sector in Italy is the luxury sector. So this sector will be immune or will change?
I think luxury sector, probably it will be more immune, I would say, at least in the actual space of product making, right? Maybe the marketing, their marketing, if you are Louis Vuitton or L, you know, what is the parent group? LV, whatever, I forgot now. But there are these parent groups. But yeah, the marketing maybe can be digital. But like product creation, yes, the luxury sector very likely to. But going back to your original question, like think about it. Maybe to me, mass market digital transformation will influence a lot mass market, right? Mass market, and will make it even bigger of what it is today. But then, if Italian design is going away from mass market, and I think it has been going away from mass market in a way, a lot of the mass market going elsewhere, then it means that like perhaps Italy will be focusing on more special products, right? It's not going to be both, I believe.
There is a question. Having more than 50 years of work in product development in fashion industry, can you lead me to divert career toward new tech,
One of our, or a member of the audience said that, like, if I've worked in 15 years in fashion design and I want to change like in AI, I mean, I assume it is like changing, still being a fashion designer, but working more with, you know, with these new technologies. I mean, if I try to do it myself, not as a fashion designer, but as a software designer, and I realize actually I need the other company. I need to be in a company that does this. I cannot do it alone because it's too complex, right? These things, like the thing is, if you are a fashion, then, I mean, you have certain options. You need to work at Zalando, at Yuke's, at all of this, or maybe there is if someone is in India, maybe there is a big manufacturer where they're doing this. So it depends. It's kind of like it's a path that may take years also because things are changing. It's not like I can suddenly change the job and do it. But I'm finding out that today there are few companies that do this because I'm also interested in this category, right? Working, making real products but through data. And today there are very few places because it's the beginning. But perhaps in 5 years from now, 2, 3 years, 5 years from now, we will see more and more companies doing it that way. And that's the mass market, essentially. The Amazon, the Zalando, the Yuke's, the Uniqlo, maybe Benetton is doing something like this. Who knows? Gap. So mass market will go full digital with data. But then there is also the very nice curated, you know, expensive luxury objects, whether it is fashion, accessories, art, this will be probably immune, and maybe there is a rejuvenation of that, essentially. But and this will happen in the countries that have the history to do it, of course.
Another question is, Microsoft will come in Italy, like, you know, I remember maybe I think Apple has in Naples a new headquarter about innovation. Do you think that Italy will be for Microsoft a place to be?
For Microsoft is strong in the enterprise typically. I mean, we tend to say that like we lost the consumer, meaning like we have where the business is doing well in the enterprise. Enterprise means services and products for the big companies essentially. And yes, Outlook, you know, like Bing. These are the consumer products. They're not as successful as Google, obviously, or, I mean, we know it and we kind of like giving ground to those. So it depends. I mean, typically you see Microsoft present in markets where there are big companies that are using these services and less in the consumer space. And maybe Huawei, you said Huawei was in South Italy, right? But Huawei is selling devices and it's very, very consumer oriented. I mean, they do a lot of other stuff like infrastructure for 5G and this big lifting, you know, heavy lifting technology behind. But they're also very strong in consumer space, Huawei. I think it's the second largest mobile company manufacturer in the world today.
I don't know if you agree, but I think that your work is, you're a growth hacker, you know?
Growth hacker, me?
Do you agree with me? I mean, growth hacker is someone who experiments, you know? It's like experimentation. Do you agree with this?
I like the experimentation. I never like the repetitive stuff. And maybe that's why sometimes I find myself in trouble in where I work. I mean, I have survived until now because they find me valuable because, I mean, my case is a bit special, even inside Microsoft, because, in fact, sometimes I wonder how valuable I'm inside the company or not, because sometimes I have ideas that they cannot use. But still, maybe they think I still want a person like him because I have these ideas and I push the envelope and they think they see value there. But there are other designers who are very much more productive. They do boring things to me and they do well, but
I don't know if you agree, but the best companies, I think they know the meaning of growth hacking, you know, the experimentation. They have a spin-off inside where people from different studies work together to create something new.
Yeah, it has to be the right company. It has to be a company that they can afford to do this. And typically, mid-sized to larger companies can actually do it. Financially, they can afford it. Smaller companies, if it's a smaller company, it has to be a smaller company that has this culture, a startup, essentially, that says experimenting continuously as a startup until they survive or they close. But if it is a small company that do traditional things, you can't do that because they need, you know, everybody needs to contribute to.
You also worked for startups. And do you think that your career helped you to be the one you are now? I know this is obvious, but this way of thinking, you know, experimentation, something new comes from your work.
Yes, I think it's maybe more like something personal, I would say, rather than I worked in a startup a little bit in California and then I tried my own company when I was in China and kind of failed also design, right? Because my best balance, and maybe this is a personal thing, I like to start the new inside the big company, which is difficult sometimes because the big company has the funds to do it, the money to do it. But it's also difficult sometimes because big companies are bureaucratic, right? You cannot move very fast.
Yeah.
But for me, somehow trying to innovate, at least in a mid-sized to big company, is a better deal. Some people love startups, but then they keep moving. Every 2 years, you know, you need to keep moving to new companies with a startup, most likely.
Yeah, there are a lot of questions. When you talk about Facebook, the question is about privacy. You know, you talked about the images, how big companies can solve this problem. So have big data without losing your respecting the privacy of people.
Yeah. Yes. Unfortunately, that can only be solved, I think, in my view, only by society. And a society, I mean, governmental, you know, initiatives that happen at the government level or the European level, whether it is US or China or Japan. I don't think companies, especially private companies, they may say that they do the privacy, etc. Maybe legally they have to. If they have to, it's because of regulations that come from the governments, essentially. In Europe, for example, they had this 2 years ago, I think the GDPR is a very big thing. And Microsoft went all in to comply at the cost of a huge cost, actually, because they wanted to do it. But if there wasn't GDPR, I don't think they would be doing it. I mean, businesses are very... And so I see two forces. One's that like top down is government, right, and society. The other force is like bottom up, which means we users can actually say no to certain things, which is a bit difficult sometimes because there's no alternative in some cases, right? But I don't think companies per se, they will take the cost because it costs a lot of money to do it in the right way.
Okay, so there is another question. talking about your career, your work, maybe a piece of advice for people who are following us this morning.
Yeah, an advice on what specific though? Some must be
a little tip from your experience in life.
I see. Yes, and in general, maybe as designers, I guess most of the audience are involved in design. In general, there is one thing is that like think. I would say think both. Try to combine the local and the global together. Right. Sometimes we forget
local.
That. Yes, in a sense that like I always find it fascinating because the local always give me inspiration. There's so much variety, right? But then the global is actually touching the very big topics that we need sometimes to solve through design, like society, you know, accessibility, climate, consumption, happiness, things like this. I like that combination. And then obviously you can't ignore technology. Unfortunately, it's here, and either you can embrace it, right? And if you don't like technology, let's say you hate it and you don't want it, then you could focus very well on things that are like handmade and it's luxury and it's like high end, right? Then you become like really a different type of designer, and then you can go truly wild. You can do anything you like. But of course, the commercial implications, like how do you make a living out of it? You need to consider it. So Isabella has a question.
Yeah, the last century will be the merge of art, fashion and technology. What do you think?
I mean, Isabella always has difficult questions because I know. Yeah. Do you think that with the turn, can you show the question?
Yeah. The last century will be the merge of art, fashion and technology. Do you think that technology will merge with fashion? This is the century of...
I think fashion and technology definitely will merge. I don't know if art will merge, but technology in fashion design and product design will merge. In the mass market, though, in mass market, not in the luxury or in the special things, probably. And it's already happening. It started happening.
I have a personal question. Do you think that the big data will replace the trendsetter?
The trendsetter,
right? The people who go all around the world.
Find
new trends.
Oh, I see what you mean. Like when there are people that are looking
cool
around.
Cool hunter, sorry.
Yeah, very likely, because now the data is digital, so it travels within seconds all over the world. Even now, maybe, you know, if there was a machine, they would analyze something about this video. So definitely, these signals are all over the world. We call them the cloud, right? They're digital signals in the cloud. And so there isn't the need actually to go manually and pick them up. However, there may be other, imagine, for example, if you are looking to understand the more esoteric or local things that we need to look into design, let's say going into a village in Africa, in Kenya, or in Brazil, or in Germany, or in Scandinavia, yeah. And try to see what do they do in this particular thing with this particular piece of cloth or furniture or technology. This thing, you need to go there as a researcher and go deeper and understand it, right? Whether it is in your area or... So again, it's not a replacement. I don't think technology always replaces something. And then what happens is that like we have time to do something else, and a new need is arising.
So do you think that actually these cool hunter, real people which have a human sensibility, will be replaced by big data? Or do you think that we always need the human sensibility
will increase, actually. I think the connection with the human need will increase. So the designers would pay more attention to those needs. As I said, the human, the climate, the accessibility, empathy, understanding the others. So these are the new materials called the materials. They're not materials, right? But they are like meta materials. In the making, production and repetition, yes, that could be done by the machines.
We have another question always about career. So is there a typical course, short term or long term, which can be start
Yes, there are many actually available in these platforms, like also LinkedIn Learning, Coursera, you know, there are these platforms that exist.
Udemy.
Sometimes awesome. Universities, they give them. But like because they are short, typically they're digitally delivered, right? The majority that I know are online. Yeah. And some of them are actually fairly simple, like the beginning. But, you know, there is a point where if you want to go deep and do it well, then you are becoming a programmer, actually. You need programming. And I even looked at this myself and I said, well, no, I don't want to be a programmer. I mean, I just want to understand it and let someone else. But maybe some of you are passionate and young enough to invest in learning about, maybe you don't necessarily need to learn the programming, but understand what these programmers do with the data. Because at some point in your career, you will meet them. You will meet these analysts that are coding. And my worry is that actually these analysts will have better understanding of what should the design should be. So how am I going to direct or have a point of view about design when the data person will have a better perspective? The data person may not be creative, may need the imagination of someone else, but maybe then the power is going to that person rather than the creative person.
Okay, there are a lot of people here in this chat, and I think all around the world that are afraid that the artificial intelligence will shrink the positions for designers. What do you think?
Will change the positions. I think, first of all, I don't think technology will take over fashion. I mean, we still need clothes, right? We still need, we are physical beings, so we still need to produce and consume objects, fashion, accessories, furniture, cars, electronics. Definitely, we will be producing these. The thing is that, like, how we will produce them, right? And how do we make the decisions? And so that's what I said, meta designers mean we need to learn to design differently with different process. And think about it, when today we make a decision like, I like these colors in my collection, right? Sometimes it's a personal choice, or maybe a team sits down and says, we like this color palette, let's go with that. Well, in the future, the machine will give us a better answer, right? So let's leave you to the machine, and maybe it is a better, even in the doctors today, may have actually an advisor that tells you what is the disease, and the machine confirms it. But we still need doctors, we still need the human. We still need the creative person, though, to decide, I like this color palette that the machine offers me, right? And I want to combine it with this. So that's why it's not going to be a replacement, but I think you need to start understanding how the designers will be thinking and working a few years down the road. And again, it will take years. It's not something that happens fast.
There is a question by Benedetta. So yeah. Can you share something more about your personal career, people you met in your path?
Well, for me, it was a bit like an unusual career because, as I said, I studied the fashion and product, and then I decided I like the new, the modern, the tech, and I had to go to something else. But I thought that the contrast, anytime I jumped from, like, it's like going from cold hot water to cold water, or, you know, every time I changed my context,
perspective,
like whether it is that even when I went to China, I mean, I went there, I didn't even, they sent me there for a program, and I have never been there. And suddenly it was a shock. And then I kept learning a lot and learning and learning. And after 2-3 years, I realized there's so much going on. The same, actually, from fashion to technology. So for me, it worked like this, going from black to white and back to black and then back to, and every transformation, maybe that's transformation.
You are a human transformation.
You need, if you want to have growth, you need to give up something and abandon it and do it the other way. And maybe you go back after some years and you think what you knew in the past helps you actually to go forward, right?
Yeah, I agree. Okay, I think that, thank you so much, because it's almost an hour we are here. So here it is, Benedetta. Thank you again, Yanis, for your presence.
Yes, thank you again for Benedetta for organizing this, and Nicola as well. And also thank you to Isabella Cascianelli, who introduced us, I would say, who is also, actually we're here thanks to Isabella, who created the connection.
Thank you, Isabella.
And thanks, Isabella. Thanks to all the people that were with us today. We have been talking about artificial intelligence, the appliance of this in design, technologies, also to beauty, to human life, to data. We have spread up many, many topics. And it's very interesting always to share the experience of these job profiles, these high profiles with our students and people who are interested. So thank you very much, Yannis.
Well, it's a pleasure.
It's very late in the US from Seattle. So it's almost midnight.
Okay, so it was a pleasure. Thank you again, everyone, and have a good day. And well, if you can find my LinkedIn profile if you like, and you can freely connect, and we connect from there. Thanks a lot again. Take care.
Bye. Thanks to all of you, and see you next appointment with this webinar. IID is open. Bye.
Thank you. Bye. Bye. Bye.